Again, thank you for having me come. Thank you to Tom for being generous and taking time with me to show me around. You have a beautiful sanctuary, very nice. And a dear friend here this morning, Karen Ritter. Karen was a part of our church for several years, and I miss her. Jonah went to Nineveh. Now, if you just read this chapter, you would have discovered that Jonah was a wild success. The city changed in 40 days. But if you know the rest of Jonah, the book of Jonah, you know that Jonah was a rather reluctant prophet. It said that the word of God came to Jonah a second time. First time it came to Jonah. Jonah, instead of heading east, headed west and had an incident at sea. And apparently Jonah learned his lesson and decided to go east when God said, go east. What I saw in this passage today was not the trials of Jonah, a fascinating story, but I saw in it the possibility of what one person can do, or one church can do, or what a few churches can do. Our church has been involved with Sanctuary. We have our second guest staying with us. And I've done a lot of thinking about Sanctuary, and I'm more the logistics guy. Gary and I have talked many times about logistics. But that's not what I'm going to talk about. Instead, I'm going to talk about Sanctuary from a number of perspectives, from the perspective of the person in Sanctuary, from the perspective of the people outside your walls, the community, perspective from politicians, and the perspective from the church. Eric's song, Invisible, is quite a good song when speaking of somebody who comes into Sanctuary. For the person, for our guest, Oscar, and for Minerva before him, Sanctuary is overwhelming, surreal, confusing, depressing. Neither person wanted to come to our church. Neither person wanted to meet us as much as we wanted to meet them. As much as we were falling in love with them, they kept saying, but I'm probably not going to come. Because they're in denial. Even though they had an order to go away, they really never expected that day to come. And when that day comes, they couldn't figure out what to bring. The media kept saying, we want to take pictures of them packing. The family looked confused. Said, we're not going to pack anything. We're just going over here a couple miles. We're not going to bring anything. This won't last, I don't think. As we spoke with Oscar, and as we spoke with Minerva before about what Sanctuary would be like, what it was like staying in our church, what we are going to do, it was like we were speaking to them in Norwegian. And I use that term deliberately because they're the only immigrants, apparently, our government wants to have. We want people coming to our country who are white and Protestant and calm and can handle winter. Instead, we have Oscar. He can handle winter, by the way, probably better than all of us, because he works in winter. We'd speak to Oscar and to Minerva, and we'd talk to them, and it was clear the words weren't sinking in. And how could they? Oscar's world is falling apart. Nothing seems to be working. All of his plans that he made with his family, they're slipping away. His world is crashing in. He's been told that he is a dangerous criminal. And he's being treated like that as well, at least by Immigrations and Customs Enforcement. To avoid deportation, Oscar has to live in what must seem to him like a rather disorganized and confusing jail, our church. Now, from the community's perspective, there are a range of responses that we received when we talked about having people come into sanctuary. Some people thought we were going to hell. They kind of think that about our church a lot.
We know that.
Nobody has issued any active threats against us. We decided we'd call the police if that happened. But we heard some negative opinions. And that doesn't include the things that you can read on Facebook or the discussion sections and in the news media websites where they allow people to make comments. Julie and I decided that we would leave some of those negative comments on our Facebook page because the negative comments really sound stupid, number one, but were rebutted, not by our members, but by people around the country who would write in. Somebody from New York, somebody from Kansas City would say, no, what you're writing isn't so, this is so. Then we thought, okay, we'll leave that stuff up. We've told the family not to look at Facebook. They probably have. It doesn't do you any good when they're having negative things said about you. But for every negative thing we've heard, for every complaining phone call or email or letter we received 10 and maybe 15 times as many comments from people saying, how can I help? And think about that, church. How many people in your community come to your door and say, how can I help you? It's hard enough to get you to help you. We had people send us money, people we didn't know, from around the country, saying, thank you for what you're doing. I was pretty thankful they did send us money because as we were talking about sanctuary and as we were beginning our public conversations about it in earnest, several people said, well, what's this going to cost? I had no idea. So I said, it doesn't matter what it costs. We'll have all the money we need.
Amen.
And somehow that worked. We had all the money we needed. We never asked for money. We did on Facebook, and we invite people to give money, and on our website, we never said to the church, we're passing the basket again. Sanctuaries had no impact on our church's day-to-day budget. So people stopped fussing about money and worried about other things. And the money we had left from when Minerva was with us we gave to her family. And the money we have left when Oscar leaves, we'll give his family the money as well. So we had good community support. And there's the political. If you think about sanctuary for 2 or 3 seconds, which the way I thought about it when I first started thinking about it, you run into the idea, well, illegal is illegal, and it's illegal. Until you discover that there's a range of responses, and when you unpack that statement of somebody being illegal or somebody being undocumented, it's simply absurd. In an analogy, I thought about how many of you hurried to church today? Pushed that speed limit, did you? Drove a little too fast, did you? I did. I was late. And I knew it. But you know what happens around Mevin. And around, if you don't know what happens around Mevin, what happens around Mevin is there's state police officers. And they're waiting for you. And I saw the first officer in the distance, but I slowed down. Then I saw the second officer, then I saw the third car, and thought, okay, I'll be late. Driving the speed limit is simple. You either are or you aren't, or you're going the right speed. And thank goodness there's often, in my case, not always, but often there's some grace and some discretion on the part of people who have to enforce the speed limit laws. Immigration is complex. People don't leave home unless their sense of home has left them. Let me give you a couple little quotes from a poem called Home, written by Warsan Shire. She writes, "No one leaves home unless home is the mouth of a shark. You only run for the border when you see the whole city running as well. Your neighbors running faster than you, breath bloody in their throats. No one chooses refugee camps or strip searches where your body is left quickened and leave your clothes behind and crawl through the desert and wade through the oceans, drown, save, be hungry, beg, forget pride. Your survival is more important. No one leaves home until home is a sweaty voice in your ear saying, leave. Run. Run away from me now. I don't know what I've become, but I know that anywhere is safer than here. Oscar is an immigrant. Minerva is an immigrant. Another word for immigrant is sojourner. Guest. Stranger. And the Bible is clear about a few things. And how we are to treat guests and sojourners and strangers, immigrants, is with kindness and respect. That's what God commands. When we explain to someone that we have a person living in our church to protect them from the government. Government who wants to split them up from their family and send them back to their country, even though they've lived in this country for any number of years, and consider the United States home, where they've paid taxes, where they've worked hard, where they're proud to be. People who have been forced to leave their home here and told to go somewhere else where they were born are so fearful because they know their lives will be in jeopardy. Because everybody knows where they're going. Oscar from El Salvador. Everybody in El Salvador Oscar meets will know that he came from America. And so he must be rich. And so a good ransom will be paid for his children. Oscar told me, just very matter of fact, that if he goes to El Salvador, he knows, with his family, he knows his children will be kidnapped. They will be killed. When we tell people that we're protecting our guests from being separated from their children, they usually just say, well, that's just wrong. A woman who does my hair, who is as Southern can be, and more Southern than all of us, I would guess, she's clipping my hair, and I'm thinking, got a sharp object against my head, but I'm going to tell her anyway. And she stops and goes, Paul, that's just wrong. It's just wrong, I guess, unless you were a politician of a certain persuasion. And then you use politics to gin up your own causes, and you say, throw everybody out. Our country's had a long and troubled history with immigration policies. Since the 1840s, I think, we've said, well, anybody can come, unless you're Jewish, or unless you're Irish, or unless you're Catholic. I guess Catholic and Irish are the same. Unless you're from Asia, or if you're from Africa, or if you're from Latin America. We've put such restrictions on people coming from Latin America now. The African population is beginning to increase, making some politicians nervous. Because we really want to keep our nation. But if you're from Norway, you can come on over. From our church's perspective, Sanctuary has been a fascinating exercise. First of all, by our participating in Sanctuary, we're protesting a law, a set of practices that we believe are immoral. We're taking a stand, a public stand. Eric, you talked about being invisible. Oscar's not invisible, and that's what's uncomfortable. He can't be seen because he's inside, but he's totally visible. For us, for our church, taking a public stand and saying that something is wrong is probably a relatively safe form of protest. We really believe that immigration and customs enforcement agents aren't going to come to our door. seeking Oscar or seeking us, they won't like the optics of arresting somebody in sanctuary or clergy or lay people of the church. And we know that. And they know we know that. From the church's perspective, there's another aspect of sanctuary. Sanctuary takes a lot of people. We had over 150 volunteers when Minerva was staying with us. A few were from the community. And again, people willing to come to your church to say, how can I help? It's just amazing. But we had more people from our church. Our helpers did the glamorous things like laundry, shopping for somebody else with their food list. Not what you thought they should be eating, but what they wanted you to buy for them. That's a sensitive subject. You have to buy what they want, or else they won't eat it. It took us a while to figure some of this out. People made meals. People brought in meals, nice meals. Not what they wanted to eat, of course, but they were nice meals. And it took us a while to work through that relationship of, we don't want Mexican food. Can we have Chinese food, please? Can we just have a pizza? That was part of our learning. And many folks, most of our folks, what they did was they were hosts. That involved sitting in a room across from the rooms where Minerva and now Oscar lives, listening for the door, waiting for a doorbell to ring. We're waiting for ICE agents to come. We know they're not coming, but we're waiting and we're ready. We're prepared and we know what to do. And if anybody else comes to the door, we answer the door because Immigration and Customs Enforcement cannot enter a dwelling. That's what we hope they think we are, a dwelling. Even though we're a church, they can't enter a dwelling unless they are invited or the door is opened. So they can stand outside and stamp their feet and knock on the door, but if they don't have a warrant, they cannot come in. So we tell our volunteers, make sure you know who you're letting in. Ask if the person's expected, and otherwise just don't open the door. So our church, our folks at church watched the door. They made sure our building was safe. They tried to help our person in sanctuary not be bored out of their minds. Because the fact is, sanctuary is really boring. We limit how much outside time our person has because we aren't sure whether they could be picked up on our grounds. We've had a lawyer tell us, well, I don't know. It hasn't really been tested by case law. So, you know, you can test it in the courts. And we thought, we'll just stay inside. Thanks. Nothing happens. We had 150 people come to our church where nothing happened for 3 hours or 8 hours or 12 hours. Sanctuary is mostly not glamorous work. And our folks loved it. They felt called to do it. They felt good about what they were doing, in part because they got to know Minerva's family. In part, they got to play with Minerva's sons, 4 and 7. You got boys, 4 and 7? You lose weight. We get to know Oscar's family and his children. One's five, but she's a girl, and we gave her a tiara to welcome her into the church, and she wears her tiara. We fall in love with them as well. And our people learn about one another. Because even though we scheduled the one volunteer leaving and the next volunteer coming to be really an exchange of the ring of keys, what actually happened was people would spend 15, 20 minutes talking to each other, saying, "Oh, you're Pam. I've never met you." Our folks all wore name tags because I told them to. Do you wear your name tags? Bogger? It's about like our church. You don't like name tags, do you?
It's missing.
I don't either. But name tags become a badge. And it gives you ownership. You are representing the church. Now in here, there's a lot of you, but when you're by yourself in a building, you have a name tag. You take things a little more seriously. Everyone wore name tags. So people would talk to one another, and new friendships were made, and we gained members from people coming to volunteer at Sanctuary. We gained lots of new friends as well. People felt like their gifts and what they had to bring to church was important. You probably have heard that before. Your gifts are important. I don't know how much you always believe that. I understand. I say it to my people as well. But our folks who help with Sanctuary have a deeper understanding of what that means, of how important their time helping in Sanctuary was. Jonah converted Nineveh. We still have a ways to go. Oscar was the 34th person, I believe, presently in public Sanctuary. Many of those people are still in Sanctuary. A few get granted stays of their order of deportation. You have to get that right. Stay of the order of deportation. You got to learn the lingo if you're going to do this. A few left Sanctuary and hid, and a few left Sanctuary and were picked up. A few turned themselves in and returned to the place where they were born. Then we're going to make Minerva take a bus to El Paso, and then, to El Paso. She said, "I don't know anybody in El Paso. I don't know anybody even around there. My own state is like 500 miles from there." But that's as far as they were going to bus her to El Paso. Minerva, luckily, had her case dismissed. It was due to a technicality, and there was another technicality that we didn't have to invoke that allowed her the chance to have her case dropped, and perhaps we even allowed her a chance to become a citizen. But it's a dim hope. And of course, after Minerva left Sanctuary and her case dropped, a new case was developed against her. And now she wears an ankle monitor, as does Oscar. Oscar really has no hope for a legal solution. The deck is stacked against people who are in Sanctuary. Oscar's hope, and many people's hope, is that a member of the U.S. House of Representatives or of the United States Senate will offer a private bill dismissing the charges against him, in this case, and will put him on the road to citizenship. It's been done over 2,000 times. Every representative we've talked to said, you can do what? But it's been done. That's what Oscar wants. That's what we want. That's what we hope for. That's what we agitate for. That's what we sign petitions for. It's either that, or it's wait for a new administration in Washington. So whatever, we hope Oscar can stay. Tom asked me to touch on this question, how my involvement with Sanctuary has affected my sense of spirituality. I confess, and Karen would probably bear this out, that I'm religious. I'm not very spiritual. I kind of just do my job as a pastor and go on and plod on. And if I can make a confession to you, I've been a minister for a long time, and a lot of my buds are retiring. And I keep thinking, can't I do that? Can't I stop? Can't I have a day where I have nothing to do? I don't really mean that. I love working at our church. I love what I'm doing. I know I have miles to go, but just sometimes looking forward to doing nothing seems appealing. And yet by the grace of God, or perhaps by the humor of God, who sometimes laughs at us when we complain to God, I've figured out how to add sanctuary to the already full schedule and full life I lead as a minister. Somehow I've learned, our members have learned, that we all have more we can give. Sanctuary's made our church a stronger church. We've gained some members, gained lots of visitors. We've had a couple members leave, but they needed to leave anyway. We're kind of happy. It wasn't a discussion, they just stopped. Tension is gone. People in our community, though, they know us. To the point of just about everywhere my wife and I go, grocery store, restaurant, concerts, just about everywhere we go, someone comes up, sometimes two or three people come up and say, thank you for what you're doing. But as is said, your mileage may vary. Sanctuary is not easy. It takes an enormous amount of organizing. And we haven't changed Nineveh yet. But we found that sanctuary has made us a stronger church.